TCU comes out, purple matte helmets, anthracite jerseys, and purple pants, and the Horned Frogs will receive. It's a touchback, so TCU will start from its own 25-yard line. KC Paulhall saw some time last week. In fact, he came in the third series against Texas, played the rest of the way. This is his first start since week two when he broke his non-throwing arm. Had some rust last week in the loss to Texas, just 13 of 34, 139 yards, no touchdowns, and a pick. They're hoping Paulhall, with a week of practice after getting thrown in the fire last week, can provide a spark to a TCU offense that's been lagging all season.
He didn't get much help from his receiving core, dropped 9 or 10 passes last week, and then with the rush of Texas, it was very tough for him to get anything done.
Paulhall to throw on first down. The pass is tipped, intercepted by Nick Kwiatkowski, and we've got our first turnover of the game on the very first play.
Following the same recipe that's plagued them in the past, as we mentioned before he came on, very good on defense. You're going to see get a little rush up here. And he tapped ball, hit by Kyle Rose starting today for the first time, but great TCU defense, but tough to start when you're backed up in your own red zone.
So West Virginia looking to cash in off the turnover. Clint Trickett, the Florida State transfer, making his fifth start of the season for the Mountaineers. High snap. This is Charles Sims, the Houston transfer, who's West Virginia's leading rusher and also leads the team in receptions. And that's a gain of 9. Hawk for Trickett. Communication from the sidelines running the offense, it's been an issue at times. He graduated Florida State early. He's kind of looking to get going and getting this Mountaineer offense going today.
Not going to help. We learned earlier that Ronald Carswell, one of the receivers, not starting, not playing because of a team rules violation, but he needs to be more efficient. Clint Trickett's got to deliver the ball.
Here's Sims. And he picks up a West Virginia first down, but hang on, there's a flag on the play.
West Virginia really struggling in the red zone, and usually that's because of a lack of a power running game.
Offside, number 25 of the defense, lined up in a neutral zone at the snap. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
That's Kevin White, the junior cornerback, so West Virginia gets the first down on the penalty.
Get these quick strike offenses, those corners are going to walk up and try to press and reroute early because it's a quick throwing game, and then your corner sometimes gets offsides.
On first and goal, this is Sims again, and he's tackled by Jonathan Anderson after a gain of 2. It'll bring up second down and goal. West Virginia, the quarterback position, it's been a revolving door for most of the season. Trickett has stabilized that a little bit. Paul Millard was the starter the first two games, then Ford Childress for a couple of games. Trickett started his first game against Oklahoma State. The Mountaineers sprung the upset, but Trickett winless since. Back to Sims on second and goal. And he's trying to fight through that purple wall. Tackled again by Anderson, only a yard. So now third and goal.
West Virginia trying to help themselves in the red zone with a little power running formation. Clint Trickett under center with the tight end and two backs being able to run the ball a little more efficiently out of formation.
TCU defensive line has held up pretty well this year, even with reigning conference player of the year, Devontae Fields, out with a foot injury. Trickett throws. That's batted down by Sam Carter, the strong safety. Fourth down, and here comes the field goal unit.
Had a fake dialed up last week. West Virginia did against Kansas State. Did not work. Dana Holgerson told us that he felt like he had to pull a few more rabbits out of the hat just to help them get some offensive production.
Josh Lambert has been pretty good inside 50, 9 of 10 on the season. This is a 24-yarder. For the redshirt freshman from Garland, Texas. Kick is good. West Virginia on the board first. 3-0. The Mountaineers getting 3 off the TCU turnover. Nick Kwiatkowski off the padded ball by Kyle Rose, and that leads to the field goal. TCU's path to the Big 12, it's been a long and windy one. We'll pick it up in 2010, where the Horned Frogs accepted an invitation to go to the Big East in 2011, finishing that season with aplomb. 2012, TCU went 7-6, 4-5 in the Big 12, and then 3-5, 1-4 in the Big 12 this season. They were originally a part of that Southwest Conference, now defunct. Didn't get the Big 12 invite when a lot of those Southwest schools went to the Big 12, jumped around the WAC, Conference USA, the Mountain West, and now in the Big 12. And Gary Patterson's team, the first half has been a struggle. Only 5 offensive touchdowns in the first half all year. They've been shut out in the first half in 3 of their 5 conference games.
They opened it up against Texas, had a double pass, and ended up throwing a touchdown last week against Texas, but 3 previous games really inept.
Here's B.J. Catalan. He took a kickoff back for a touchdown against LSU in the season opener. Out of bounds near the 30-yard line, and that's where the Horned Frogs will start their second drive. The first drive, Hawk, lasted just one play. Casey Paulhall had his pass tipped and intercepted.
Well, the offensive line has really struggled. The starting right tackle quit before the season. Guard has to quit because of injuries. That leaves you very thin anyway. And that's the big issue offensively for TCU, is getting the offensive line to protect the quarterback and being able to open some holes and get the running game going.
TCU without wide receiver Brandon Carter today, out for personal reasons, according to the team. On the ground here on first down, not much room for Wayman James, who was the team's leading rusher in 2011 and missed most of last season with a torn ACL.
Number 98, Will Clark for West Virginia, getting up there. He's a real force, leading their team in sacks. And I think they can get pressure on both sides with Golson as well. West Virginia was in 2 deep, only playing a 7-man box here, so the numbers say run it, but got to be a little more efficient than that.
B.J. Catalan into the game is running back. Mountaineers bring pressure. Paulhall completes to the freshman Ty Slanina, and the speedy Slanina picks up a first down, finally brought down by Darwin Cook after a gain of 13.
Great job by Casey being able to see the pressure. West Virginia changing late, rotating down late. Nice identification by Casey Paulhall.
With the issues TCU has had up front, Hawk, how does that affect the offense when you're not getting the initial protection?
It's a lot of problem because it forces you to go to the quick game like they did there. You're limiting your running game.
Paulhall back to the air, wide open over the middle, David Porter. And he's got another first down for TCU. One thing TCU is looking for is a go-to wide receiver. They haven't had one all season.
Yeah, and unfortunately, they have to end up using Boykin, also as a quarterback, out of receiver as well.
Pressure again from West Virginia. Paulhall with some time. And that's what we're talking about. That one is dropped by Josh Dotson, the Wyoming transfer. We saw a lot of that last week in the loss to Texas.
Got to be able to convert that a little bit. That's tough. Tough on your quarterback, tough on the continuity. And Casey Paul is doing a nice job seeing the pressure and going to the right receiver. He's got to be able to make a play. Mixing up the tempo, TCU going a little faster on the last bigger play, this time huddling up. A little more effective getting into some complicated running games and protections when you huddle.
That's Aaron Green, the Nebraska transfer. He picks up 3. It's going to bring up 3rd down and 7. TCU on the season has struggled on 3rd downs, 29%.
See the other side there of West Virginia defense, Brandon Golson, number 2. I think between he and Clark, probably 2 of the better ends in the league, just in terms of their ability to get up the field and disrupt the offense.
We've got a timeout with 10:37 to go in the first quarter. Yeah.
There is no foul for an illegal substitution. The timeout was called prior. Timeout charged to West Virginia. This is their first of the half. There will be timeout on the field.
Rick Lumiere, the head referee, will step aside with 10:37. Hailing West Virginia 3-0. The Horned Frogs turned it over on their first possession. West Virginia got a field goal. TCU facing a 3rd-and-7. The Horned Frogs have lost 2 straight. They have never lost 3 in a row since Gary Patterson has been the head coach. Paul Hall throws, completes near side. Ladarius Brown, and he's got a first down, finally wrestled out of bounds by Travis Bell. Brown has come on of late for TCU. 13 catches entering today in his last 2 games, just 10 in TCU's first 6 games.
Much better protection by TCU. West Virginia running a cross stunt on both sides of the defensive line, but picked up well, and Casey being able to deliver the ball without somebody in his face.
This is Aaron Green, and he picks up 3. Green got the start last week against Texas. B.J. Catalan and Wayman James did not play in the first quarter of that game due to a violation of a team rule.
West Virginia doing a nice job mixing it up, showing a 2-deep shell, shuffling down and bringing some pressure, have given Casey several different looks.
Play action, Paul Hall hit, throws, completes, and that's Doxson inside the 10-yard line. A gain of 19, and it's 1st and goal, TCU.
Casey got hit right at the end of this. Nice job delivering the ball. A lot of teams in the country doing that, faking that outside run that affects the outside linebacker, and then being able to throw the seam route in behind.
Here's Gary Patterson, 61-12 at home as the head coach at TCU. Came here as a defensive coordinator under Dennis Franchione and took over after a few years as the head coach.
One of the things that happens with defensive coaches when they're head coaches, just their nature, is the offense usually doesn't put the defense at risk, and that's been the problem this year. They turned it over inside their own 5-yard line against Texas last week. But typically a defensive coach's offense is very efficient.
Trevon Boykin checks into the game for TCU, number 2 in purple. While Paul Hall was out with that broken left arm, it was Boykin playing quarterback, but Boykin's sort of their slash. He can play wide receiver right now, lined up in the slot, bottom of your screen. Paul Hall throws too high, and that was nearly intercepted. Intended target that time was Cam White. White back in the lineup this week after missing last week's game with a concussion.
This is what makes it tough on a spread offense when you get down here, because you're always outnumbered, and you have to just get into a power running set. And your running back's got to make people miss or run people over. You don't have enough blockers, and it's hard throwing the ball when the safeties aren't having to play deep.
And it's tough for the line that TCU has this year to bully folks, especially at this end of the field. Boykin now in the backfield. He's going to throw it. At least he was going to try to. Now Boykin trying to make something out of nothing, and he dives inside the 5-yard line, but it brings up 4th and goal.
Doing a nice job. They're trying to throw it back to Casey Paul Hall here. Had him for a second, but because of the pressure, had to be able to pull it down. K.J. Dillon did a nice job for West Virginia, picking up Casey coming out of the backfield. Looked for a second like he was going to be wide open.
So the sophomore Jaden Oberkrom on for the field goal attempt. On the season, he's been money inside 50, 10 for 11. 22, and that's good, and we're tied at 3. So TCU marching downfield on its 2nd possession, comes away with a field goal. Here's Dana Holgorsen. He's endured a tough 16 games since West Virginia started 5-0 last year. The Mountaineers are just 5-11. So much lost on offense with the departures of Geno Smith and Stedman Bailey and Tavon Austin. K. kick bounces out of the end zone. West Virginia starts at its own 25-yard line. And really replacing those guys, they've had to piece together almost a Frankenstein offense. Quarterback Clint Trickett came from Florida State. Charles Sims was at Houston last year. Dremus Smith, the backup running back, a JUCO guy. Three junior college guys who figure prominently at wide receiver. Carswell not playing today. Dakeel Shorts played high school ball last year. Then you bring in three new offensive coaches. It's tough to have any sort of continuity.
Yeah, it's hard. They said it's just weird looking out on the field and seeing nobody from last year on this year's team.
This is Vernon Davis on the fly sweep. And Davis gets a yard. It'll bring up second down and nine. Jonathan Anderson, the former safety, now a linebacker on the tackle.
You see TCU making an adjustment right on the motion. Gary's just such a great teacher, Gary Patterson, on defense. They don't just play a defense. They defense plays. And every little indicator you give, they're onto it. As soon as they went in motion, they were in a total fly sweep adjustment defensive pattern.
Trickett to throw on second down, well short of his intended receiver, Mario Alford. Alford part of that junior college triumvirate at wide receiver along with Kevin White and Ronald Carswell. Alford getting the start today with Carswell suspended because of a violation of a team rule.
Saw Clint Trickett doing a good job getting the ball out early, which is what he does. He's a good anticipator, but not necessarily the kind of arm strength that's going to drive that 18-yard comeback on the sideline.
Trickett 1-for-3 in the game so far. Throws over the middle. That's caught. It's the true freshman, Dakeel Shorts, and he takes it to the 40-yard line, a gain of 14.
Great job seeing the adjustment and the roll of the coverage on the back end. Safety's kind of tilted over to the right and did a nice job driving that ball inside.
Shorts, a guy who's played well at home this season, not the case on the road. That was just his sixth catch in this West Virginia's fifth road game. He's got 26 in four home games. Play action. Trickett to Sims. The running back also leads West Virginia in receptions. And, Coach, we're going to see a lot of that from this Mountaineer offense, dumping it off to good old number three, their old reliable.
And that's been their forte, is catch and run and get yards after contact, yards after the catch. That's not been something they've been able to get done this year.
You don't see Stedman Bailey and Tavon Austin and J.D. Woods on that list.
Bailey and Austin doing a nice job for the Rams, Los Angeles, or the St. Louis Rams right now.
High pass, it's hauled in by Jordan Thompson. It's a gain of 8 yards, a first down for West Virginia. Don't forget, college football continues on ESPNU tonight. ACC matchup, Badley and Georgia Tech. Look for its third straight win. Yellow Jackets home for Pittsburgh. That's at 7 Eastern tonight. Pistol look on first and 10. Back to Thompson. And he's hit shy of the 40-yard line, a gain of 5. On the tackle that time, Chris Hackett, TCU's leading tackler. It's tough to take shots downfield against this TCU secondary. Jason Verrett is an All-American. Sam Carter, Elisha Olabode back deep. Kevin White's pretty good. It's one of the better secondaries in the country. And, of course, you got Chris Hackett, who's got 3 picks as well.
Yeah, and it's hard by the nature of their formations where they're not necessarily max protecting.
Trickett. That time, he finds a receiver. It's a first down. Alford on the catch. Caught it in front of Kevin White. It's a gain of 11.
Here you say West Virginia is trying to go a little bit faster.
It's a completed catch. First down.
They'd like to go fast, but they've not been able to play at the kind of tempo just due to the inexperience.
The previous play of a completed catch for a first down is under further review.
It's tough. You want to get it right, but kind of disrupts the flow of the offense.
Oh, I think that's coming back. Not sure he had control.
Well, we'll see if they can get 12 out of 12 jurors to approve that. It can't be 11 out of 12. It's got to be a unanimous decision.
It's got to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call. But right there,
yeah,
looks like Alford's juggling the ball and it hits the ground. You talked about tempo, Hawk, with Clint Trickett. That's been the issue, communication from the sideline and running this offense at the tempo Dana Holgorsen is used to.
Well, and then you have all those new receivers, too. So everybody's trying to get on the same page. And, you know, typically in this type of offense, your quarterback can control the routes on both sides with hand signals and or be able to see the adjustments by the defense and do different things. So trying to get all 11 guys on the same page is tough when you're going fast.
And you think of it from the perspective of the skill players, they've had to adapt and adjust to three quarterbacks this season.
Yeah, definitely a little bit different that way as well. You know, the beauty is, again, a guy like Gary Patterson, when you play against great defensive coordinators and you are a huddle team and you get into formations, they're going to dial you up. They're going to have an adjustment for everything you have. So going fast sometimes at least helps limit what the defensive coordinator can do to impact your game plan offensively. We're kind of entering that side of the field here down in the red zone. West Virginia has really, really struggled down here again. Unable to. They gave the ball to Sims three straight times before they kicked the field goal last time. But this is where, again, you got to have a running game that can break tackles and run into safeties and get some stuff done.
After review, the ruling is that it was an incomplete pass. The ball will be returned to the previous spot, which is the 41-yard line. It'll be third down.
Love the fact they got it right. I'm lobbying for a live official in the booth with a headset, guys wired up, watching it just like we're watching it, talking, communicating, so we don't have to stop and have indisputable evidence. That's what I'm lobbying for.
Need a petition? I can get you one.
You're the man. You're the man.
Third and six now, West Virginia on the season, 30% on third downs. Empty look as Sims goes wide. Trickett hit as he throws it. Incomplete. That time TCU brought the corner blitz with Jason Verrett, the All-American.
You're going to see Jason Verrett going corner blitz coming from the boundary here on the right-hand side of your screen. Does not get picked up, just a little bit late.
Verrett a semifinalist for the Thorpe Award. That's given to the best defensive back in college football. Nick O'Toole goes by the nickname Boomstash. He's out punted away. Takes a bounce inside the five. The ball crossed the plane of the end zone. It did. In college, it's a touchback. So TCU gets it at the 20. We check in with Dari Noga.
Anish, let's check in with the Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. We'll stay in the Big 12. John Hubert takes one to the house for Kansas State. He's got 73 yards on just four carries. K-State leading Iowa State in Manhattan 10-0, guys.
All right, thank you, Dari. Kansas State knocked off West Virginia last week.
This happens every year.
Let's take a look at the punt one more time. As soon as the ball crosses the plane, it's an automatic touchback.
Yeah, and as soon as you step in the end zone and hit it, it becomes a touchback.
Trayvon Boykin in the game at wide receiver for TCU. On first down, that's B.J. Catalan, and he's across the 30-yard line of the 31, a gain of 11. And a first down for the Horned Frogs.
Doing a good job seeing two deep coverage, being able to hand the football there, running against advantageous numbers.
Pistol look here on first and 10. Four receiver set. Paul Hall to David Porter. Gets a block. And then he gets out of bounds. Marked out at the 39-yard line. It's a gain of 8.
People People talk about tackling in modern day football. When you have good athletes out in space and you throw those kinds of plays, it's hard getting a guy down when you have no help.
DJ Catalan on second and short. Looks like he's got enough for a first down. TCU moving the chains. The West Virginia defense comes into this game really beat up and banged up. A lot of injuries have taken their toll. The Mountaineers started off playing well on defense this season. Played well in the win against Oklahoma State. But since the Baylor game where West Virginia got lit up for 73, the coach is telling us it took a little while for the defense to get its confidence back after that game. Baylor scored 56 just in the first half.
You think?
Yeah, that'll stay with you. Jared Barber on the stop as B.J. Catalan picks up two more. It'll bring up second and eight.
A lot of shuffling going with the defensive line. That's one of the difficulties in a no-huddle offense is they really wear that group up front out. Normally you want your defensive linemen playing three, four plays maybe. Get on these big drives, it's tough.
Safety blitz picked up by TCU. Paul Hall taking a chance deep. Doxson makes the catch inside the 20-yard line.
Great protection, good job picking it up. See right here, stepping up, good block. Casey Paul giving Doxson a chance to make the play. Ishmael Banks on the coverage. Doxson doing a nice job holding him off a little bit there with his hand, then going up and making a play.
When these two teams played last year, it was Banks who was burned on that 94-yard touchdown in the final 2 minutes of the game that allowed TCU to tie it, send it to OT. And the Horned Frogs ended up winning in double overtime. Here's Boykin on the screen. Trayvon Boykin tiptoeing the sideline. He's going to be marked out at the 11-yard line. It's a gain of 9.
West Virginia had numbers out there. There were 3 defenders on 2 receivers. Shows you how strong they feel about throwing it out there anyway. Then just here's your missed tackles. And they threw that play last week. And we're able to go double pass against Texas for a touchdown.
With Trevon Boykin in the game, it opens up the playbook for this TCU offense. Here's Catalan. Got a couple. Enough for the first down. B.J. Catalan, a sophomore, started low on the depth chart last year. Due to some injuries, got a chance as a true freshman, ended up leading the team in rushing. Had the most rushing yards by a true freshman since Aaron Brown in 2005.
I think he's definitely the guy they want to go to. Unfortunately, you can't have issues with violation of team rule.
Paul Hall, touchdown pass to Doxson, and that's Casey Paul Hall's first touchdown pass of the season.
Same play they ran in the first drive. Fake influence, the backer. He's got to step up and then just run a seam route in behind, and the safety unable to make a play inside of that ball.
Big first quarter for Josh Doxson, a transfer from Wyoming. 3 catches, 66 yards. Point after is good. Casey looks comfortable in the saddle. And his first start since week 2. It's Doxson long downfield. And then short for the TD. With Dan Hawkins and Ish Schroff early on, coach, a good sign for this TCU offense, which has struggled in the first half all season.
Get much more production. They had the 1 negative play to start the game. But have stayed in manageable situations. The running game's not been great, but somewhat effective. And then the big play to Doxson.
Casey, Paul Hall has looked much better this week than last week. This is technically his first start since week two. He came in on the third series a week ago, 8 of 11 with a touchdown pass in the early going.
Doing a nice job getting the ball out early. And explosion plays you have right there. Expect West Virginia to take maybe a shot on this drive. We haven't seen that yet.
On first down, there's Charles Sims, and he runs into a sea of purple right at the line of scrimmage. No gain.
TCU always good on defense, but Chucky Hunter and Davion Pearson in there, those are two big guys, well over 300 pounds. Tough to run the ball inside against those two.
Play action. That's caught by Kevin White. Makes a couple of guys miss. Still on his feet. And he fights to the 30 for a gain of 5. It'll bring up 3rd and 5. Kevin White's the guy coaches say can be the best receiver on this Mountaineer team. He's been better of late, but inconsistent for most of the season.
Slippery. TCU did a good job, and that's where those screens to throw a 5-yard pass and you get the 70-yard gain. You get those experienced guys that got some skills.
Trick it on 3rd down. That was intended for Shorts. Incomplete. Broken up by the safety, Olabode, and it's 4th and 5.
Really nice job by Olabode. Both defenders underneath jumping a route and then running to the corner there, which not really his route to defend. But Olabode doing a great job getting his right hand in on the ball.
Nick O'Toole on to kick it away. Going around that West Virginia campus for his mustache. It is Movember, for those of you that follow. Cameron Eccles Looper on the punt return. 4-yard return off a 39-yard punt. 8 seconds to go here in the first quarter. TCU up 10-3. Not far from Amon Carter Stadium, Texas Motor Speedway, as the Sprint Cup Series starts to wind down. Jimmy Johnson and Matt Kenseth locked atop the Chase standings. Both have done real well at Texas Motor Speedway. Kenseth, 7 wins. Technically, he's in first because of the number of wins. Both he and Johnson have the same amount of points, 2,294.
You got a driver? You're down there in Charlotte, Anish. You got a driver favorite?
Can't say I do. I like Kyle Busch, though. He's got a little swagger to him, kind of the bad boy of NASCAR.
That is the end of the fourth.
We've played one quarter here in Fort Worth. TCU's offense finally has a bit of swagger. The Horned Frogs up by 7.